Hello, welcome back to my channel. The design work on my 6V6 power amplifier is progressing, so I would like to take this opportunity to provide a little bit of tutorial on the phase splitter and on the first gain stage of the power amplifier. So we will see how to properly design those two very important stages within a power amplifier. I really hope you enjoy this video. Thank you very much for your attention. This is where we left last time. As you remember, we almost defined all details of the two 6V6 push-pull power amplifier. As you remember, we plan to deploy a 300 volt power supplied again, push-pull stage, which according to the simulations, the calculation, will be capable to deliver about 15 watts. What now is interesting is the voltage I need to apply to the 6V6 tubes pair in order to drive them to maximum power. This information is very important for sake of design of the phase splitter stage, which is the stage which is before the 6V6 power tubes pair. You see here the operating point sits at EC equal to minus more or less 22 volts. So my input swing goes from minus 22 volts to almost zero, maybe a little lower than zero. Remember, we are just looking at one tube. So the whole push-pull pair can be driven to maximum power with an input voltage swing of 22 multiplied by 2, which is 44 volts. I'm maybe oversimplifying things because, as you remember, here we're speaking of an AB class amplifier. So each tube works for EC equal to VG in other notations, even lower than minus 22 volts. But again, in order not to get things too much complicated, let's stick with minus 22 volt, which means again an input voltage swing of 44 volts. So this is the phase splitter stage. This stage sits before the two 6V6 tubes pair. The role is to drive, of course, the two power tubes and to provide two very similar but different versions of the input audio signal to each one of the two power tubes. In particular, the two versions are one at the opposite phase of the other, one at 180 degrees from the other. In order to achieve that, I typically use the long tail pair phase splitter, which I believe sounds really good. How does it work? As you see, this is composed by two triodes which are included in the same tube. So you see the input grid of the first triode is my input signal. The input grid of the second triode is connected to ground. How does it work? If we increase the input signal at the input of the first tube, what does it happen? The current flowing through this first half of the phase splitter is increasing, of course. So also the current in the tail resistor increases as well. Cathode voltage of the second triode increases as well, as well as the cathode voltage of the first triode, of course. As you remember, the grid, the input grid of the second triode is at ground voltage. So if we increase the cathode voltage of the second triode, this means that I am driving the second triode with a lower input signal. In this way, the current on the second triode decreases. In this way, you understand, while in the first triode I have an increasing current, in the second triode I have a decreasing current. And all these current variations are reflected in the plate voltage on the first and on the second triode. In this way, at the two outputs of my phase splitter, I can get two perfectly specular versions of my input signals. Are they, as I said, perfectly specular? Well, no, because if you look at the first triode, this acts as a sort of a cathode follower. And you remember from maybe my previous videos, the gain of the cathode follower is not strictly one, is a little lower than one, is typically 0.90 something. So not 100% of the input signal is passed to the second triode, which means that the gain of the second section is slightly lower than the gain of the first section. So in order to get exactly the same gain over the two sections, we will see later, we will need to slightly increase the plate resistor of the second triode. You remember, in fact, that the gain comes from the value of the plate resistor as well. So let's design our long tail pair phase splitter. One first very important decision is to again decide how much of the global high voltage, of global B plus voltage, can be spared between the tail resistor and the plate resistor. The higher the tail resistor, of course, the higher the cathode voltage of the two triodes, the lower the voltage swing over the plate resistor, which means the higher the balance between the two sections. In this case, as you remember, one important specification for each and every tube is the maximum allowed cathode to heater voltage. So if we increase this tail resistor too much, we might need to elevate the heaters in order to comply again with this maximum heater to cathode to heater voltage. On the contrary, for lower values of the tail resistors, we have a lower cathode voltage, a higher unbalance between the two sections, and a higher voltage swing over the two plate resistors, which can drive the following stages. So, as usual, we need to decide for a compromise. My rule of thumb, which I experienced over the years, is to have 20% of the high voltage on the tail and the rest shared between the plate voltage and the tube itself. All the following exercises will be based on this decision. So, having said that, let's again proceed with the design of the phase splitter, and let's start from my requirements. What I need to achieve with this phase splitter. First of all, I need to provide a voltage swing from minus 22 to plus 22 volt. As you remember, this should be a little higher than that, but just for get things simple, let's stick with that. Also, I need to correctly drive the load of the power tubes. In this case, the input impedance of the power tube stage is more or less 100 kilo ohm. So we will see that properly driving this kind of load is not a problem for the tubes we have defined for the phase splitter stage. So let's start with the first attempt, I would say. We will utilize ECC 81 tube, which is equivalent to the 1287 tube, with 250 volt of B plus voltage applied. As I said before, we decided to split this B plus into 18% voltage on the tail, so the cathode voltage in idle condition should be 45 volt, and the rest, which is 205 volt, available for the tube's plate resistor. We will start from a pretty high value for the plate resistor. You will find this so high plate resistor value for the ECC 81 in many very good vintage amplifiers. So let's see what happens with this kind of high value. You will see that I personally don't like this kind of high value, because I prefer to lower a little bit this plate resistor in order to achieve a lower output impedance, and we will see also a lower distortion. Many tubes amplifier in the past had a high amount of negative feedback applied, typically 20 decibels. I would like to implement a lower amount of negative feedback in my amplifiers. But let's see what happens here. So let's plot the load line. You see in the horizontal axis the load line starts at 205 volt, because in order to design the phase splitter we're not considering the tail resistor, because tail resistor is in common between the two sections of the tube. Which is the steepness of my load line? We need to calculate the resistance coming from the parallel between the plate resistor and the equivalent input resistance of the next stage, which is for both is in this value is 100 kilo ohm. So 100 kilo ohm in parallel with 100 kilo ohm gives 50 kilo ohm, and this gives the steepness of my load line. So the load line crosses the vertical axis at 4.1 milliamps. Once plotted my load line, let's define a good operating point. In this case I have chosen 2 milliamp as idle current, which sits at 105 volt, and it corresponds to minus 1.52 VG applied to the input grid of the first triode. I tend to choose high current operating point at any given condition, so for example at any given load line steepness, because I have experienced that it gives better sound, again every other condition being equal. We can see that in order to achieve an output swing of 44 volt peak to peak, it's sufficient to apply a signal between minus 2 and minus 1 volt at the input grid of the first triode. Now, just one thing I maybe didn't properly mention before. So now we are seeing the load line of a single tube. We will see that this is exactly the same for the second tube belonging to the phase splitter, and there is one moment we'll see later when we will consider that we have two tubes other than one. So what we are seeing here is the output swing from a single tube, but we have to think that the situation is exactly the same for the other tube. which is the main driver which makes me decide between one situation and another, so between one operating point and another, and one setup and another. Many factors, for example the output impedance we will see later, etc. One of the most important, I think, is the expected distortion. Here we have an expected distortion of 1.5%, which is not so bad. Also, we have to think that the this kind of phase splitter has an inherent negative feedback, so at the end the real distortion will be much lower than that. So this 1.5% is not bad. Again, we can do better. We will see later. This value of distortion was automatically calculated with the help of a website I'm posting here for your reference. Credits to this very good website. But you can even roughly guess which the distortion is looking at the spacing between the different load lines. If you see the load lines for VG equal to 0 volt, the load lines for minus 1, for minus 2, minus 3, the most those load lines are equally separated each other, the lower the distortion, of course. And if you look at the crossing point between my load line and the lines for VG, again equal to 0 to minus 1 minus 2, you can see that situation is not so bad with regards to equal spacing, but we can maybe do better than that. Thank you.